Okay, I am Irati Uriarte and I am a PhD student of the University of the Basque Country. And after Peter's presentation, what I'm going to do is to apply the gray box modeling in the PSA, Plataforma Solar of Almería Data Series 16 and 17. And then I will give you an overview of the applied data and I will do the analysis using CTSM in R, which Peter already explains. So this is the second presentation from today. It will last more or less 1 hour with the questions and the presentation. And okay, well, the aim of my presentation is to estimate the heat loss coefficient using gray box modeling method in CTSM in R using the provided data. I must say that I have already used other methods also in order to compare the results. And these methods used were the average method and a LORD that I think you have already worked with too. So from all the methods, I was able to obtain similar heat loss coefficient results, which is something really good because it means that the models were quite robust and also the results I do obtain are quite reliable. But however, during this presentation, I will only work and I will only show you my procedure during applying the gray box modeling to this data. So I don't know what's your background, but I'm going to do a little bit of, I'm going to explain you a little bit the background of the heat loss coefficient. In order to work with parameter, it is very important to know what the performance gap is. This performance gap is the difference that exists between the real energy consumption and the design energy consumption in a building. This performance gap can be created by a lot of different sources. However, one of the main sources creating these uncertainties is the building envelope. And the best way to energetically characterize this building, building envelope is the heat loss coefficient. This heat loss coefficient is the sum of the transmission heat loss coefficient will consider the heat losses through walls due to the bad insulation and these kind of things, and then the infiltration and ventilation heat loss coefficient, which will consider the heat losses through window opening or door opening, maybe holes in the walls, and these heat losses. So the sum of these two parameters will form the heat loss coefficient, which is the parameter that I'm going to estimate using gray box modeling. I think you have already been working with it, but the case study I'm going to work with in my presentation is the round robin box. This experiment is a very interesting experiment because it's a first step to work with before starting working with real buildings that are probably more complicated than this one. So once we know to identify how this box behaves and how to identify everything here, we will be able to work with this analysis also in real buildings. So this test box, as I suppose you already know, is called round robin box. And what we want to do is to analyze how it behaves. Then it has a cubic form, as you can see in this photo, and this is the volume of this box. And then you can see that not all the walls are opaque. It also has a window area here oriented to the south where the solar radiation can enter to the box and also affect our result. And we also need to consider. And then we also must consider that the box is floating in the air in order to avoid the ground effect in the lower part of this box. Then we also must talk about the location and the period we have about the, when we analyze this box. This box was installed in Plataforma Solar of Almería. And it was monitored between the 6th of December of 2013 and the 7th of January of 2014. And it was monitored under real weather conditions. It means that the data we are using is completely real. It's measured by the sensors. And then this box was monitored using several sensors. there were a lot of sensors installed there, and they were measuring different variables. For one side, the temperature, then the solar variation, the humidity, some of the wind characteristics, and also the heating. Inside the temperature, they were sensors in order to measure the air temperature. So there were four sensors for that, two of them in the exterior part of the box and two of them in the interior part of the box. Then there were also 14 surface temperature sensors, half of them outside and half of them inside, located in the surface of the box. And there were also 8 average temperature sensors, also located in the surface interior and the exterior. Then we can see that there were also a lot of sensors in order to measure different solar radiation affecting the box. And we can see that some of them were the vertical south, the vertical north, and the horizontal global solar variation sensor. Then we also were able to measure the beam solar radiation and diffuse solar radiation. And finally, also the long wave radiation was measuring the horizontal and vertical planes. So then we also have the relative humidity of the box, affecting the box, and also we have also information about the some wind characteristics that were the wind speed and the wind direction. And also the heating was measured. One of them, one sensor was installed in order to measure the heat power. And then there were also some inner surface heat flux sensors located in the surfaces on the interior part of the wall. So the data was recorded in for every minute and in GMT timeframe. However, we are not going to use all this data for the analysis of the heat loss coefficient. We only are going to estimate the parameters that I'm going to show you here. For this estimation, we only need, first of all, the ambient temperature, which will be measured using two air temperature sensors, two of them, one of them located in the lower side of the box in the exterior, and the other one more or less in the middle side of the box. Then, something similar happens with the interior. There were also two air temperature sensors in order to measure the air temperature inside the box, one in the lower side and the other one in the upper side of the box. Then also the heating power was measured, where in this case, instead of using a heating normal heating system as in a building, an incandescent lamp of 100 watt was used for that. And then you could see in the previous slide that we have a lot of information about different solar radiation affecting the box. But in this case, as I told you before, the window was oriented to the south. So that's why, in this case, the vertical south global solar radiation will be used, since will be the one affecting the most the box and also the heat loss coefficient result. Then, as I told you before, it is measured minute by every minute. However, when I tried to work with the models of the gray box modeling, I found difficulties to make it work, and I had very bad residuals, or I wasn't able to make the models convert. So what I have to do with the data was to convert it in hourly data. So once I have present all the variables I'm going to use, I have plot all of them in order to see their behavior. In this case, we can see that the heating system, is presenting some periods where it is switched on, off, and then it switches on, and again, then we have another part where it is again switched off. So when I try to plot the data, to run the data with the models, I realized that I also have some problems when running all the data set, and I wasn't able to obtain good results or to make it convert or to obtain good residuals. So that's why I focus where the problem could be in my data. So in this case, I thought that maybe the problem could be in this part of the heating system, that maybe it was difficult for the model to model this data, and that's why I decided to take a period or to select a period where my heater was switched on. And that's why I decided to select this period. This is in data series 16. So in data series 17, we can see that the heater is working almost all the time, but I have the same problem. I tried to run my data with the models, but again, I was not able to obtain good results for any of the models. And what I have to do was also to reduce my data set to a shorter period. So in this case, since the heating was all the time more or less working, I thought maybe the problems were coming from the solar radiation part. So from previous experience, I know that the solar radiation is one of the variables creating more uncertainties when estimating the heat loss coefficient. So that's why I tried to select a period where the solar radiation was showing a low values. So that's why I select this period of 3 days. So my new data sets are period between the 9th of December and the 13th of December for data set 16, and the new one for data set 17 is the one between the 18th of December to the 23rd of December. So this will be my new data set for analyzing later. But I invite you to try testing the data minutely, introducing the whole data set, then reducing it maybe in minutes, because maybe the problem can also come from other parts of the models. So I know Peter already have talked about the gray box models, but I'm going to give you a short resume about modeling, just to remind. So the gray box model are used in order to identify the internal dynamics of the buildings, or as it can be in this case, a box. And this method works with model cases. And inside these model cases, we need to include or to have some previous physical knowledge in order to make proper estimations. So as Peter told us before, what we need to do is to start modeling the most simple models, and then go making them more complicated and seeing if they are improving the residuals or not, or see what happens. But it will depend always on the data. So we know that there in these models, a physical part is a stochastic linear state space model, and the dynamics of the states will be written as shown here, where we can see that T is the state vector. Then the U are the input is the input vector where we will introduce the data we have in this case. As I told you before, we have the ambient temperature, the heating system data, and also the solar gains. And also in this equation, we will also need to estimate A and B, that will be the parameters that the model needs to estimate, that I will show you later also when I start presenting the models. And finally, also the error part. So here you can see one of the models. It is presented in RC mode. And you can see that this is the most complicated model, where doing or combining the different parts of the circuit, we will obtain the different models. In this case, we have 6 parts, which are the interior part, the medium part, the heater part, the solar radiation part, the envelope part, and the ambient part. So here we can find 4 state variables that will be combining them, we will obtain different models. And in this case will be the interior temperature, the medium temperature, the heater temperature, and the envelope temperature. And then we can see that also have we also have other parameters, which are the thermal resistances and heat capacitances, which will be also the relation between the different models. For example, the relation or the thermal resistance between the interior and the medium will be this one. Then the interior with the heater will be this thermal resistance. And this way we can combine them between them. And also the same with the heat capacitances, that will be each of them in each part of the model. Then we also need to estimate the standard winner processes and also the incremental variance of the winner processes. And as I, as Peter told us before, what we need to estimate is the maximum local, likelihood estimate for each of the models, or and see which of them, which one of them is the one providing the higher value and the best, in consequence, the best model. So once we know something a little bit, the gray box model, it's time to start modeling the gray box model. So first of all, what we need to do is to introduce the data inside the program. In this case, as Peter told us before, we are going to use R. I don't know if you have already used R anytime, but this software works with different packages. So in order to make it work and make it work with the data we want, we need to charge some packages that you have first need to install in your software. So in this case, the packages I'm going to use are gtools, which will charge some R tools that I need to use later. Then lubridate that will allow us to work with data times, and also CTSM-R that of course is the one that we are going to use for working with our models. And then it is very important to set the directory in order to make the software know where we are or where, and where you need to take the files that you are going to use. Then we need to call the data, and for that I suppose you already have this data in CSV files. So by reading these CSV files, you will be able to introduce this file inside the software. So in my case, the name of the file with the data was Almeria 16, and I had it inside a folder null named data. So this way, the program is able to recognize this file. Then you need to say that you want to have the headers, and also it is important to set the separation where you have for the decimals and everything. And then once the data is already inside the script, it is time to identify all the data and modify it. So what we need to do is, in this way, we already have it called, we already have all the data inside this file. So I add in the signal, the dollar sign. You will be able to introduce the name of the column. In my case, this was the name of the first column that was the one we have the date. So for me, it was too complicated to start all the time writing this. So I decided to change the name of the column now to date. So now I will have a new name for my column. Then I will do the same with TI, with T1, that will be in this case TI app, for example. And once you have changed the names and everything, you will be able to manipulate your data. For example, if you want to, obtain the average value between these two temperatures, the two of them in the interior, to see the value and everything, you will be able to do it now because it is easier to do it before starting modeling. So you can manipulate everything you want and then save it in this data frame you create. And then once you have all the data as you want, you will be able, in the case you want to put the two data sets together, to add this code and put both data sets together here. And finally, using this code, you will be able to save it. The new name for my data will be this one, and I will save it in a file called data1 in this case. So this will be after readable for the analysis with the code, with the model, sorry. Then, once I have created the data readable for R, I recommend you to change the script. I used one file for the data manipulation and everything, and then I used another file or a script for working with the models. So now we can start working with the models. So again, we call the packages we will use for the analysis of the data, which are exactly the same as in the previous one. And we will set again the directory since we are working with a new script. Then this part is a part I have added because in my case, what I have done is to include all the models in a different file where I create them as a function. So adding this code, I will be able to call them one by one instead of having all of them together in this file, because maybe it's too long for later identifying errors and everything. So in my case, what I have done is to save each model that I'm going to show you later how to create in this file and go calling one by one. And with this, we can charge them in this file. Then I also set the latitude and the longitude. And finally, I call the data I created before. If you remember, this is the name I showed you in the previous slide, where I have already manipulated the data and I have the data as I want. So as I told you before, I wasn't able to make all the dataset work in hourly or in minutely way. So what I have done is to select shorter periods in order to see if this way I was able to obtain better residuals or to make them convert. So this is the way as you can select the time or the period you want to work with. For example, in this case, I have select my second period, which is the data series of 17, of the series 17, and from the 18th of December to the 22nd of December. So I put here the days I want, the first day and the last day, and then the software will be able to estimate or to select only the data I want to analyze. Then once I have selected this data, I will be able to plot it and to see if my data is behaving as I want or if this is the data I want or not. So here you can see that using plots or lines, you can represent any parameter that we are using, that in this case, as I presented before, are the heating system, data, the temperatures, the interior and the exterior, and also the solar gains. So once we have this, I will present also this last part that it helps me also a lot when trying to estimate good residuals. Why? Because as I told you before, the gray box model sometimes has problems to model the model well, the data when the switcher is switched on or switched off. So due to these difficulties, I add these weight vectors where I made the models behave differently when this happens. So the noise, in this case, the noise level will be higher than the data level. So it will be easier for the models to obtain better residuals in this case. So it will be everything for calling the models. So now it's time to start modeling the models. As I told you before, I will start from the most simple case, which will be TI. Only is the one presented by Peter also in the previous presentation, where we have the interior part with related with the heater, the solar part, and the ambient. So this is the most simple case, where we can see that the interior part related with the ambient can be represented this way. Also, the interior part with the heater is represented this way in the system equation, and the interior part with the solar is represented in this way in the system equation. That will be the one identifying our values. And also we need to include the part of the error, where we can see that I have included the weight part, that is the optimization part I presented before, with the error part. So once we have created the system equation, we have to introduce also the input data. Here, the input data is the same presented before, the temperature in the ambient, the heating system, the solar gains, and finally the weight presented before. Then also the observation equation is set where we have the temperature measured before, that we have already measured the interior temperature, and the temperature the temperature that is going to be estimated by the model. And then we also set the variance of measurement error. And as Peter also tell us, we have to set the limits. Here, as in this case, the state variable is the internal temperature, we need to provide an initial value for the initial for this state variable. So we provide the initial value, and we give a lower limit and a higher limit for this temperature. And we need to do the same for the rest of the parameters, which are the capacitances and resistances. So the capacitances, resistances, also here we have the rest of the parameters of the error part, also the solar aperture, and the part of the weight. So once we have limit, the lower limits and the upper limits and the initial value, this is ready for running. But I'm going to create more models in order to see what happens when we increase the level of the model. So in this case, instead of only one state variable, we will have two state variables. So we have, again, in this case, two system equations. The first one is Ti, as in the previous one, but in this case, we have to relate the interior with the heater, the interior with the solar, the interior with the envelope. That this will be the first part of the equation, the one related with the physical part. And then we have the part of the error, also is the same as in the previous part with the weights included. And here we have the second system equation, which is the one related with the envelope. This envelope will be related again with the rest of the parts, with the interior, and in this case the ambient too, and we will also include the part of the noise. Then the input variables will be the same, then the observation equation is exactly the same, and the variance of the measurement error will be the same also. And again, we have to set the limit for the state variables we have in this case, that are the interior temperature and the exterior temperature at the beginning, or the envelope temperature, sorry, in the beginning. And then we have the rest of the parameters, the capacitances, the resistances, the ones in the error part, and the aperture and the weight one. And then what we are going to do is to include one state more. In this case, we have Ti, the one as the previous one, Te, that was also in the previous one, and Th. So what we need to do is exactly the same, relate the parts with the others and obtain the system equation for each of the state variables. Then include the input here, which are the same as in the previous case. Then set the observation equation, exactly the same, and also the variance of the measurement error, which is exactly the same. But again, we have to add some more parameters. In this case, the new one is this TH at the beginning, and also some other parameters, again, the capacitances, the resistances, and everything. So this will be all of them for TIT and something more. But in this case, if instead of using TIT, if we use TITM, we need to change again the system equation and of some of the parameters. So in this case, again, we create again the system equation for TI with the rest of the parts of the model, in this case with TM, so this will be the relation, and then the one with the heater and the solar, and then TM with the rest of the parts of the model. So then we include again the input variables, which they don't change. Also the observation equation is the same, because we are using also TI here, and we set the variance of the measurement error. And then we change again the parameters that we want to estimate. In this case, is TI again zero? This is the same as in the previous one, but we need to include this TM zero. And then include also the parameters related here, also with the lower limits and the upper limits. And if we include an extra state variable to this one, will be TH again. So again, we need to create the system equations. Okay, this is all the time the same, and it's what you need to do with all the models and with all the relations you can find. There are some of them extra also in this case, but I haven't included them because it's too repetitive, but it was only to see that you can do with one case of two state variables or vary them and then include one more and see what happens. Then you will see it in the results. But yeah, again, the same, the relation between the interior with the medium and everything is exactly the same. All the procedure, in order to do the system equations, the inputs are the same, observation equation is same, and the variance of the measurement error is the same. And you have to include the new parameters that you have now in your model. So once you have done this for all the models you want, it's time to start trying them, running them, no? So I will start again from the beginning, from the most simple, and see what happens when we start including more state variables. In this case, we run the model, and this is what we obtain. Peter also showed us this really quickly, and he says that here, if we obtain a high value, what we need to do is to go back again to the limit. I'm going to find this model, which is TI, is the model TI. So this will be the limit or my estimated parameter. So imagine that, that here my estimate is too close to the upper limit or to the lower limit. So in this case, imagine that we have a value of one here and this value is too close to the upper limit. So what we need to do is to go back to this model and change this value. If this is too close, if the estimate is too close to this, and if it's too close to this, we'll have to make it smaller. And we have to do it until we obtain insignificant residuals in this part, more or less like this, the very small values. So from here, we can consider that our model is already quite reliable, and we can obtain that the local likelihood we obtain from this model is quite good. So this will be the value we will save for later analysis of the models. And we also need to analyze the residuals, which in this case, we have the autocorrelation function Peter already explained us, and also the periodogram. Here in the autocorrelation function, we can see that we have this lag is too long in this case. So maybe this this model is not white noise. And also here in the periodogram, we can see that the dynamics of the building are not too well explained yet because maybe it's too close from the limits here. No, so we will see what happens when we add a new state variable here, which will be TI with TE. So in this case, this will be my new model, and I run it again, and these are the residuals I obtain. You know that if this value, if you can see a value here that it's too high, you need to check the estimate and see if it's too close from the limits, upper limits or the lower limits, and change until you have insignificant values there. So from here, I obtain this log likelihood value, and this log likelihood value is higher than the previous one, which is commonly more logical. It's logical to have a better log likelihood value when the model increases. But we are going to save it for later analysis of the log likelihood rate test. So from here, we also need to analyze the residuals. And here we can see that in this case, our autocorrelation function is quite good because our residuals are white noise. And also the dynamics are better defined here. You can see that this line is more straight. And they are not too close from the limit. So we will see what happens if we increase also one more state, the model. So again, we obtain insignificant values here. So we can consider that the model is quite good now. We cannot improve the model, and this is the log likelihood value we obtain from here. So this is lower than the previous one, so probably it won't be as good as the previous one. But let's see what happens if we check the residuals. Okay, in the residuals, we can conclude that there are also some lags here, and they are not showing as good residuals as are the previous case. So probably the previous case is better than this one. but we can also later analyze it using the test. And also the periodogram showed that the residuals are too close from the limit. And okay, now as I told you before, we are going to change TM for TI. So in order to see what happens in this model. So again, we obtain insignificant residuals, and we can consider we cannot improve more the model, and this will be the best local likelihood we can obtain for this model. So we save this model, and we also check the residuals again. In this case, we can see that they are again white noise because they are inside the limits and they are not showing a periodical behavior. And also the periodogram is showing quite good results since the dynamics are well explained of the limit. And the final model I have shown you before and I have tested in this case is this one. We also have insignificant residuals there, so we can consider that we cannot improve more the model, and this will be the local likelihood value we will obtain in this case, which is negative, which is not good news because it's much worse than the rest of them, it's lower. So probably this model will not be the best one, and we can see it also in the residuals, of course, that here we can see that the residuals are quite periodical, and they are also they also have some lags here. So yeah, we can say that we can discard this model. This won't be for sure the best model, despite it is higher than the previous one. So from this result, we can conclude that I have repeated all this procedure for both datasets 16 and 17, and the ones I have shown you before in the previous slide were these results. I haven't shown you this because maybe it is too repetitive to do it for all of them, but you have the results and you have to do exactly the same for both cases. And something interesting from this result is that the higher local likelihood for was obtained in both cases for the same model, that was TIT. In this case, the higher value was this one, and in dataset 17, it was this one too. But we have to apply the likelihood ratio test, and therefore we need to use this formula where we need to use the local likelihood of the first case minus the second case of the model, and then introduce this d-value in this equation where we obtain this p-value. So the lower this p-value is, the better the model will be. In this case, we can see that the p-value we have obtained in this case is zero, but also in this case. But as in this case, the local likelihood was lower, I have considered that this model was the best one. And in this case, the lower p-value was directly obtained with this model. So I have considered that the best case was this one. So we are ready now for analyzing the heat loss coefficient, knowing which of the model is the best for us, and see if it fits with our results. So this is the code we need to use for analyzing the for estimating the heat loss coefficient, which I have added also as a function in a new script, and using the thermal resistances obtained from the models, I have been able to estimate this heat loss coefficient and also to find the confidence interval for the heat loss coefficient and the error. And I have also done the same for the solar aperture for all the models, where I have also used this code with the estimation of the solar aperture with the also the interval, the confidence interval. So this will be the results I have obtained for the heat loss coefficient in both datasets. You can see the values I have obtained for all the models, but you can see that the ones I have selected are this one for TIT and also the one from here. And you can see that for both cases, the heat loss coefficient obtained was very similar, almost the same. Then the error was very small also, and the solar aperture obtained for both cases is exactly the same with a very low error. And also here you can see the log likelihood and the error, the p-value I have shown before. So what conclusions I can take from my study? That first of all, I was able to obtain very similar results using gray box modeling and also different methods I told you before. And this is very good for all the models, since they mean that all of them are able to provide reliable results. Also, that using this likelihood ratio test, I was able to obtain that the best model for both cases was TITE, and that the Hill-Dos coefficient I have estimated for both cases was almost the same, very, very similar. Then I have to say also that the residuals I have obtained for both models, both TITE models, were very good. I haven't shown you the ones for the dataset 16, but they were also very good. And the ones of dataset 17, you could see that they were well noised for the autocorrelation function. And also in the periodogram, the dynamics were able to represent the dynamics of the building were well represented. And also a very interesting thing is that the solar aperture for both cases was the same. So that's everything from my side, and thank you very much for your attention. I hope you like it, and if you have any question, it's time to ask.